Hello everybody, Kai Wazda with you. Welcome to back to my channel. Welcome to, it's the 4th of July as I'm filming this. I'm just hanging out. I'm gonna make some spaghetti later. And I'm finishing up my detox tea in my Fisherman's Wharf glass. And it's time for another edition of The Cheap Lounge, season two, nearing the end of season two. So what I do here is just talk about some of the records that I've loaded a little bit about the music or the artist and share some music samples of them. This week, I want to share with you, first off, this record by a group, I don't know, we may have talked about this group before, but this record was just so outstanding, I wanted to include it in the Cheap Lounge. Ames Brothers, Destination Moon is the record. It's from 1958. Such a great record, and the songs, not surprisingly, are all moon or moonlight or outer space related. It's a killer record. I love every song on it. The arrangements are fantastic, and the orchestra backing them up is really great as well, which is Sid Rahman's orchestra. I like generally speaking, like the Ames Brothers. They were actually brothers. They had quite a good career recording music. They did eventually split up in 1963, and Ed Ames, which one is Ed Ames? This one, I think. Ed Ames continued with a solo career, did very well for himself also for many years. Ed Ames currently, as I'm videoing this, is actually still living, is the only one of the Ames brothers who is still with us on the Earth plane, on this planet of Earth.
You're clear out of this world when I'm looking at you. I hear
it's only a paper moon sailing over a cardboard sea, but it wouldn't be make-believe if you believed in me. Yes, it's only a canvas sky.
I uploaded quite a few songs from this album onto Moody Blue Music. I think it's a wonderful album and I really enjoyed it. Now next, an artist that, I don't know, does he get the credit he deserves? I don't know, maybe he does, maybe he doesn't. This is actually not an earlier record by this artist, but it's a later record. And the artist I'm talking about is an organist by the name of Lenny D. Now, he had, again, quite a long career recording on the Hammond organ, sort of jazzy, some of it jazzy and some of it very more slow and loungy, but always with instrumental accompaniment, sometimes a full orchestra, sometimes, you know, small combo, but never just solo. I don't think he ever just recorded a solo organ album. It was always part of a little ensemble. He probably is best known for his 1970 hit Spinning Wheel, which got a gold record instrumental. Oh, his actual name, though I did not know this, his actual name was Leonard George Destoppelaer. I don't even know what kind of name that is. And he was sort of known for having record albums that played on his name, Lenny D. So they were like, Delicious and Delightful, Delirious, you know, Decomposed. No, I don't think that was one, but anyway, yeah. Well known for that.
Ain't no woman like the one I love.
Thank you. Something I didn't know about him until researching this was that his initial love was live performance, was to perform in a club in front of an audience, whatever, and interact and chit chat, and that was his first love. And so even though he became very successful recording artist, doing easy listening albums, and you know, had great sales and hits and whatever, he continued through most of his career to still perform live at smaller venues, you know, of his own choice, particularly several like supper clubs and nightclubs in the Florida area, Florida Gulf Coast area, where there are a lot of retirees and such, I guess. You know, his kind of music was even popular amongst the older folk. As late as 1999, he was working on a series of cruise ships, performing on cruise ships. And he did this stuff not because he had to, but because he liked it. As I said, his first love was live performance, and over recording, he actually preferred performing at clubs and places and having interactions with people. So he continued to do that. Retired actually in 2003, and then just passed away in 2006, 3 years after that. This record I'm showing you is not one of those records that's called D something or other. It is one of his later records from 1973. Now, why do I love this album? Why do I include it here in Cheap Lounge? Well, I love Hammond organ, right? I love it anyway. And he just does crazy. This is the 70s now, so he's, you know, keeping up with the times, and he's doing songs of the time. Groovalicious stuff on this record. I am loving it. It's like holiday lounge all the way. Holiday Inn lounge all the way. I could totally see this on a cruise ship. Up next, an album called Stephen Foster Medleys by Carmen Dragon, conducting the Symphony, the Capitol Symphony Orchestra. Now, Carmen Dragon did a whole series of records conducting the Capitol Symphony Orchestra, such as Oriental, Serenade, World of Music, Tempo Español. I think there's a Gypsy one too. Quite a few. Now, the reason I'm talking about this one, well, I think we all know a lot of Stephen Foster songs. They're very old, you know, written in the 1800s, and a lot of these southern kind of songs about old plantation days and whatever. My Old Kentucky Home, Oh Susanna, Old Folks at Home, and songs that we, you know, because of their racial implications or their historical whatever, like we probably wouldn't really, you know, record them or perform them today, like Masses in the Cold Cold Ground or Masters in the Cold Cold Ground. During the time of slavery, right? Some of these songs. So what's interesting about it? Well, they're beautiful songs. A lot of these songs that we know, they're beautiful, but I actually didn't really know. I have to say, I didn't really know much about Stephen Foster other than his name and that all these songs that he wrote, I was familiar with. I didn't really know anything about him. Do you? I really didn't. And just the liner notes on this record about him were fascinating. I had no idea. So let me just read a little bit from this because it's, for me, it was completely educational. I mean, I had no idea. So this is Stephen Foster, who's written all those old Southern plantation songs, right? Stephen Collins Foster was a fun-loving young Pennsylvanian of Irish and Scotch descent who grew up writing beautifully sad ballads, immortalizing plantation life in the Deep South. Kentucky eventually adopted one of his compositions as its official state song, My Old Kentucky Home, although there was no sure evidence that he ever went there. The song is filled, as many of his songs, is filled with homesickness for a way of life that he had never experienced. He never lived in the South. Never did. Lived in Ohio, lived in Pennsylvania. The other thing, I'm like blown away. No idea. Another thing that blew me away was his story, or it's just kind of sad. He wrote many more tunes that he was paid for, and rarely did he receive credit on newly published manuscripts of his melodies or shares in the profits they created. He died impoverished on New York's Bowery. Let's see, blah, blah. I'll skip some early stuff, but he kind of stepped away from music. He wrote a few things and had a little bit of success and then stepped away from it. By 1846, he had just stopped going to school, college, became a bookkeeper in a Cincinnati steamboat agency. And then he was exposed to more and more stories about the South at this time through being in that, involved with that steamboat agency, and was inspired to write all these other songs. He pursued songwriting again. One of the people that he associated with, an E.P. Christie, became the leading exponent of Stephen Foster melodies at the time. In return, Christie got exclusive rights to introduce Stephen's new numbers, many of which were published under Christie's name, not under Foster's name. He had a way for damaging his own financial interests. Most of the unfortunate deals with publishers and performers were of his own making, and he would swap a song for a pittance in ready cash. Sometimes he would swap the rights to a song for a mere 50 published copies of the song itself, just to get sheet music. Whew, it's kind of crazy. And then he did not do well for himself and was living, you know, on, as we say in New York, on the Bowery, on the skids, didn't have any money. Was quite young. He was 37 when he died, 38 years old. And sadly, we don't really know. I mean, he had a fever at the time, had fever, and he also, there was one of his friends, I think it was, that found him still alive in his place at the Bowery, in a pool of blood, lying in a pool of blood. Some say, said there was a knife, some said there was some broken pottery, you know, so, and his family sort of had different stories, so it seems that we don't really know whether, you know, he had a fever and he died from suicide, or whether he had a fever and he fell and hit something and cut himself and bled to almost to death. Like I said, his friend found him alive, still alive, but he didn't make it, and he didn't, according to the friend, didn't want to make it. So we don't really know, but sad, isn't that sad? All those songs that we all know so well, Oh Susanna, and the guy never went to the South and died 38, penniless. It's a tragedy, it's very sad.
Enjoying the lovely scent of this beautiful rose. Yes, I know, I realize, I'm just a dollar bin record. I'm just a castaway from a thrift store. But even though there is no need for you to be unnecessarily cruel by constantly reminding me of that, I'm very grateful that Mr. Kaiwaza has shown us that we are worthy of love and respect. How has he done this? He has created an online radio station that plays only dollar bin and thrift store records of easy listening music. That kind of music, well, I'm sad to say, nobody plays us anymore. But on Moody Mood Music, you can hear us all day and all night, reliving those days of glory as of old. Yes, I am. Just a dollar bid record. But I have a new home. Won't you join me at my new home? Moody Rude Music. It's so easy to access. Just click on the link below. And you can support me and all of our friends as we are played in all our glory. So you see, there is hope.
Okay, so we're going to wrap it up with a couple of interesting records that I just have so many questions about. We're both budget labels. You know how I love my budget labels. First one is one. We don't know when it's from. It's called Sing Along with Art Mooney. And these are all the songs that you can sing along with Art Mooney. Thing is, so many questions. I'm pretty sure it's not Art Mooney, number one, because Art Mooney was a band leader and a singer himself, but we're talking like a band, like Glenn Miller-ish kind of big band sort of thing. And he did have hits. Art Mooney did have some hits, but they were like much earlier on in his career. I'm looking over Four Leaf Clover, Babyface, and I'm Getting Nuttin' for Christmas. Those were all big hits of him and his ensemble. And early on, you know, you can see, like, if you check out Discogs or whatever, you can see he did some albums, you know, not a lot, but some few albums. But he's mostly, I think, from the 45 era and 78 shellacs and such. But his name starts popping up on some budget label recordings, your Promenades and Spinoramas and Diplomats and all that. This one is Sutton. This very same album has been issued under something like Campfire Sing-Along with no band, no artist listed. It's also been released as Sing-Along with Al Goodman, which we'll talk about too. Al Goodman. I kind of suspect it's not Art Mooney. Anyway, what this album is, it's a direct ripoff, a direct cash-in on Mitch Miller and his gang, who did a whole bunch of sing-along records that look like this. They're all like, they look, I have a few right here, but they all kind of look similar. That similar kind of graphic design, I think everything was that he did. And they sort of cash in on that here, but I mean, just listen, like, this is Mitch Miller. You just listen to a sample of this.
Around her neck, she wore a yellow ribbon. She wore it in the springtime and in the month of May.
And now this is Sing Along with Art Mooney. Listen to this.
Around her neck, she wore a yellow ribbon. She wore it in the springtime and in the month of May. Hey, hey, hey. And if you asked her why the heck she wore it for her lover who was far, far away. I'll do the cooking, darling. I'll pay the rent. I know I've done you wrong. Remember that rainy evening? I drove you out with nothing but a fine tooth comb.
I mean, it's exact. It's a very intentional, exact ripoff. And I will say they even, on this album, lifted some of the exact arrangements that Mitch Miller used on some of his albums for some of these songs. They literally lifted the arrangement. The only thing they did differently is they wouldn't put the same songs together that Mitch Miller, because his albums were all like medleys, two or three songs, you know, stuck together in one track. And they do that here, but they don't do the same songs. Like they'll move them around and not in the same order or not in the same whatever. But the arrangement of the actual song is identical. So very interesting. I'd love to know who originally did this. I don't know that we'll ever know. I'm pretty sure it's not Art Mooney. Art Mooney becomes associated with the budget labels on some things. A you see his name out there, it's usually on a budget label. It's usually at like a cha-cha record, sometimes a big band-like record, and then something like this. I'm not 100% guaranteed that he did any of those. Any of that music was originally his that you'll find. I don't know. I don't think this is Art Mooney. I don't think Art Mooney had anything to do with this, and I don't know how or why his name was used. I don't know how or why Al Goodman's name was used on it as well, because Al Goodman had an earlier career band leader, did a lot of, not a lot of albums, but a lot of 78, well, he did some albums, but a lot of 78 album sets, because it was that time era. Big band kind of music, really, and ish, and orchestras, string orchestras. Then later on in his career, he again also became associated with several budget labels doing lots of records that are by Al Goodman, and they would use other names too, you know, made up names, Stradivari strings, whatever. And maybe it was Al Goodman and maybe it wasn't. I question also, I don't know, I've heard it said that Al Goodman did actually do some recordings for budget labels that were disseminated. I don't know if it's real, if any of those are really Al Goodman, probably, I think, because of the sheer amount, I think some of them probably are. Art Mooney, I don't know whether any of the stuff credited to him on a budget label is actually him. I don't think this record is. I don't think we would ever know who really did this record, because it's not in... It's a direct imitation of somebody else's style, so you can't really tell their style from it. I don't know. So many questions, so little answers. The next one's one we have a lot of questions. We could have a lot of questions about too, but I don't so much because I just enjoy it. I'd like, yeah, who knows, whatever. It's by the famous Stradivari Strings, which is one of the fake pseudonyms used by some of the budget labels for their orchestra, their string sort of orchestra. You'll see lots of records out there by the Stradivari Strings, and then you'll see lots of the same albums with different titles using other names, you know, Sounds of a Thousand Strings and, you know, random names, you know, Peter whoever, Peter Knight's whatever, anybody's orchestra and chorus or something. You never know. But this one I just particularly enjoy, which is, I have a couple versions of it here. I'll go with this one. The Stradivari Strings. Music of Leroy Anderson. Here's the same record, different label, exactly the same record. Now this one is by the famous Stradivari Strings Ping Pong Percussion. So I thought, you know, it would be just like a straight orchestral recording, and then they would attach onto it these very odd and strange ping pong percussion introductions that have nothing to do with the song. They're like recorded independently, and the budget labels, whatever, had probably like, I don't know, 30 of these weird intros to choose from that they had options on or they recorded or whatever. And they would just, you'll see often on a budget label of something something whatever ping pong percussion record, ping pong percussion, and you'll get it, and it'll be like whatever recording they already had, and they would just attach one of these ping pong percussion intros on it. Well, that is what this is. It has just unrelated weird ping pong introductions. I'll give you a sample of some of them, and then they go into the Leroy Anderson composition. I thought this one would be without the ping pong percussions because it doesn't mention that at all. And I knew it probably has to exist without the ping pong percussion. I just thought this probably was, but as it turns out, it isn't. It also has the ping pong percussion. So that would have been a little surprising, I think, if you'd have bought this one and thought, well, it was a little surprising to me, but back in the day, you've got, oh, Stradivari Strings, the music of Leroy Anderson, very famous composer who wrote Sleigh Ride, amongst many other songs. Blue Tango, probably his most famous song. Anyway, yeah. You would be a little surprised, I would think, to get it home and hear these. You'd be like, what is this weird bongo introduction thing? I don't get it.
Thank you.
Because I think outside of the introductions, I don't think there's any percussion on these songs at all in the actual orchestra. You gotta love it. Anyway, that's it for today. I hope you enjoyed that. Don't forget, if you want to check out Moody Mood Music, you can click on the link below in the description box. That'll take you right there. And if you have these recordings or any thoughts about all these questions, maddening questions that we must know the answer to, you can comment below. Thank you for watching. Happy 4th of July. It'll be over by the time this gets posted, but happy 4th, everybody. And we will talk to you in the next video. Take care.